during the time when police surrounded me and had me captured and they found the gun that I have, when police come from the back, because they were contemplating about if they should kill me or not. And so one set is saying kill him, the next set is saying he can't kill him, he's a big artist, he can't do stuff like that. One set is saying set example, kill. That kind of a thing. It's all a back and forth situation. And I was just there waiting for the verdict. Police that walk up from behind me and then squeeze, I mean, like he just decided that murder's ended. And when he's pressed the trigger, you know, it just never go off, never fire.
We may look different and live in different countries, yet our stories are knitted with the same threads of excitement, uncertainties, challenges, and victories. As we journey through the ups and downs of life, it is our undeniable will and God's strength that propel us to joy after pain, smile after frowns, and ups after downs. We were born to win. We were destined to greatness. We are overcomers. Welcome to God's Scoops, Raw and Unedited Stories. Welcome to Raw and Unedited Stories on God's Scoop, the place where stories are told to uplift, encourage, and brighten your day. Today with us is no other than Tyrone Thompson, aka Papa San. He is known as Jamaica's fastest speaking DJ, a trailblazer reggae dancehall artist who enjoyed global success. Now, astonishing reggae gospel artist, Papa San. Yeah. How you do, my brother?
Oh, God is good. God is great. Good to see you, sis. Blessings to you all the time. Blessing upon you all the time. One love.
It's such a blessing to have you.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. It's my pleasure.
Now, before I begin to ask you about your story, how did the name Papa San come to be?
To be honest with you, you know, my brother, them call him Dirtsman. And one time, you know, when we were small, you know, he was stealing some buckle. So we'll go watch a movie because we used to steal a buckle to get some money to watch movies and stuff like that, you know, movie theater and thing. And it happened to be that the owner for the property that he was on actually was appeared and he tried to hide himself. And he stepped down from a step and stepped on him and walked on him and walked off. That's what I was told. And they said they can't believe the man or realize that he just walked on you. I am most dirt. So true that them call him Dirtsman. And because my younger brother them call me son. You know, hear about it become a family thing and it just stick from there. You know, back in the days when you have a name and you're gonna be a DJ, you have to put a little title to the name. If you have a name general, so are Papa, so are ranking, so are sergeant, so are, you know. So Papa does come into play and that, you know, that's what it is, you know. But honestly, if you look at it, the word Papa and son mean leader and head.
Wow.
And I find myself living out that too as well. So Papa is really an head, is a leader. You know, it's like a puppy, Papa in your home, leader. You know, so the name just kind of reveal and unveil itself in my life as well. I was always a person who lead. In any field I find myself in, I always find myself leading some way, you know. So I give God thanks.
Praise God for that. Praise God for that, Papa San. Now, where in Jamaica were you born? Tell us before we begin to talk about the nitty-gritty of your story.
Tower Street, Kingston. You know, I'm a Kingstonian, but I grew up in Spanish Town most of my life. And then my later part of my life, I went back to Kingston again. You know, so people still see me as a man from Spanish Town because that's where I spent majority of my childhood. You know, I leave from town about 2 years old and I grew up in Spanish Town all the way up until I'm in my 20s. Actually, you know, and then from there, you know, I moved back to town, you know, after a time. So they see me as a Spanish Town artist, and I don't have a problem with that, you know, but that's where everything started from Spanish Town, Spain Town, Della, Tamsepen.
Okay, Della, Tamsepen.
Spanish Della, where me come from.
So, where did your story begin? Talk to us.
It's a life journey. It's a journey of good, bad, and the ugly. You know, I have some bitter moments, some sweet moments, and some ugly moments and times in my life. You know, we never grew up in a family that have it like that. We grew up in a family that's pretty much poor, but my father was a hard worker. I work out 2-3 jobs and hustle and decide to make sure everything is fine with us. And that's the kind of dad I used to have. Look out for us and make sure we eat and our food and all of that. And when it get dry and when it get down, and when I have it, we just have to just bear it through. But you know, the father was always there for us, you know, and that's a good thing. And so go up in a neighborhood where you play a gig, you tie, you know, run cartwheel, a rose wheel, go be the river and all them thing there, and your friend them, marble, the whole regular thing where you know better you do. That's what we do as a youth growing up, you know. And we have seen tribal war till it become political violence, you know, war until it becomes, I grew through all of those era and those times, you know, in my life, you know, seeing dead bodies on the ground a lot of times, you know, friends get shot or somebody get shot, you run over to the hospital to see who gets shot. And when you look into the fridge, you have 4, 5, 6 dead men in the on ice like chickens, you know, stuck and freezing there for days and dead bodies lying on the stretcher in front of you. As I grew and see them thing that so much times. And so you grew up in so much violence. So the only thing you know to do is to defend yourself, you know, walk with a gun or have a gunman behind you. And that's what you learn. You just live what you learn. That's how you live out. And that was my life. So there are times you have fun, you know, when you go to river, you swim and you play a gig and you marble. And then that time it just get ugly. And that time it just get tough. And so it's a mixture of life for me as a child growing up, you know. And It was also like a training ground as well, you know, looking back at my life. I can do better for my kids so they don't have to travel that road as well, you know.
Mm-hmm. Papa San, I recently heard about some ghetto youths saying that they don't have anything to live for, so might as well they just get into crime and do anything because they're going to die anyway. Did you feel that way growing up?
No, I didn't feel that way growing up because I have a father. That's the key. Mm-hmm. And what causing those problems in Jamaica and all over the world is fatherlessness. Mm-hmm. And the biggest problem we have in a society is 90% of the crime and prison sentences and killings and prostitutions and a lot of these things came out of fatherlessness. If you trace it back carefully, it's because the father is not in the home. When you have a father in the home, the father knows how to affirm a young girl that he loves her. That's when you get love from first. And father says, I love you, young princess, you know, and care for your daughter. Your daughter feel the love of their father so that when a man come into your life, then they have to run and look for love. They might already feel that.
Mm-hmm,
you know? Mm-hmm. So daughter, when a girl don't have a father to affirm her, of her a love for her, you know, and treat her as a princess and care for her and have that kind of nurture inside of him, you know, manifest to her. She's going to, that void that is inside of her is no, there's an emptiness that is lacking that. And so when she get that age, she starts search for those things in different men. And that's why the first man that came along will say, I love you, and she just fall in her lap because she just so dying to hear somebody said that. And she get hurt and hurt and hurt and hurt all over again. And the next thing you know, she in a prostitution ring and a pimp becomes her father.
Mm-hmm.
And so much abuse over the years, they could become suicidal, they lost self-esteem, pretty beautiful woman that could really get a nice man to marry, feel like they are nobody because there's no father in the home to affirm the young lady that she's a princess, you know, she's a lovely woman and she's loved. And that lacking really mess up a lot of young girls. And so young girls know when they start dating and want to get married, they're looking for older man to marry because they're still looking for a father. And now they're trying to look for a father and a husband in one person. So when they get into marriage, they're trying to pull the father out of the husband and they can't find the husband, the father and the husband, and it causes problems in the marriage. And guess what? The marriage falls apart. It's the same thing with men. The men is the same. No father to affirm him to be a man. Mm-hmm. And guess what? He find a gang leader to do that.
Yes.
He can't do it. Guess what he did? He said, listen, my mother's the one who's working here. So guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to go out there and I'm going to help my mother to foot the bill. So he leaves school prematurely. He starts selling drugs. He gets shot. He gets killed. I end up in prison. This is what, if you go to prison and interviews all those men that here for jobs, I guarantee you, 98% of them don't have a father.
Mm-hmm.
I never feel that. You know, we were poor, things was ugly at times, but I did have a father.
Mm-hmm. Papa San, tell our listeners, what kind of youth were you? Because I've heard that in the ghetto, and even some parts in the rural areas, By the time a guy reaches 16, he has two and three baby mothers. Were you that kind of youth? And what did you do? How did you acclaim in that environment?
I never did one for my life, because I've seen that it came out of the same thing I'm just talking about. When you have five, six baby mothers, who's gonna father? This is why you have one man in the ghetto, him have 18 kids and don't have a job. And him have 7, 8 different baby mothers. And so those kids don't have a father because they don't have the money to feed them, they don't father them. And they're scattered all over the place. And that's where you find is a regular thing in our culture. You know, you find, especially the black community, one man have 6, 7, 8, 9 baby mother, 18 youths, and when you check it out, they don't mind not even 90% of them. You know, probably just a look after one when president live with, but the other rest don't pay no attention and no mind. I never want my life to be like that. I want my life to be steadfast and settled, you know. I got 6 kids and only one out of my wife that I have. Every other 5 is for one woman. And I believe in that, you know, and I father all my kids, you know what I'm saying? But I believe in that. I believe in just be there as a father, because it's very important. They need that. The young man need it, the young girl need that. And so most of the kids, them, they have nothing to live for because there's no father to affirm them. They feel like they're left alone and feel rejected. And this is what causing the problem. And it's a big problem in Jamaica, bigger than most of the problems you see in Jamaica right now. Fatherlessness is a major problem. If they want to cut the crime rate, don't deal with that issue. Big time. You see, now for the kids that you see on the roadside wiping car glass and man take them up in cars, give them money and have sex with them, they become homosexuals. Where it came from? Molestation. Fatherlessness, there's no father to affirm them, to help them in any form or way. To grow them up, to teach them, to show them off to be a man. We need fathers.
Okay. Thanks for that, Papa San. And I want to ask you, how were you as a dancehall reggae artist? What was your journey like that time?
Well, I grew up in a musical environment. My father, again, was a man who had a little sound system in the yard. And my house is a place where everybody used to come and come listen to music and then burn them weed and burn them chalice. And so I grew up into that kind of environment where chalice are born, spliff are born, music are played. So I grew up listening to the Dennis Browns and the John Walls and the Lone Ranger, you know, all of them artists that are coming up from, you know, the 70s, you know, and them time, the Babandi and Master Griffiths and the people. So, you know, my house was that. So I grew up musically. Musically, that's where I grew up musically. And that's why this music thing embedded in me, you know, and from an early age, I began to just pursue that as something that I want to do and get having the God-given gift and ability to write lyrics. You know, from an early age was the thing that get me off, you know, into that platform, you know.
I'm going to tell you something that is going to be shocking to you. When I was a young woman, we watched the television news and saw you on the television, and there was an incident with a family member. I wasn't sure it was your brother or your cousin, I don't remember. And it was something that wasn't, you know, that was devastating, and you were speaking on the news, and we held out our hands, a friend of mine and myself, and we prayed for your salvation.
Praise God.
Said, Lord, save Papa San, and we prayed. I remember clearly, shortly after, we heard that you became a Christian. Talk to us about that journey. Talk to us about that journey from that devastating incident in your life to becoming a born-again believer.
Man, it's just God is so good, and I thank you guys, and I thank God for you guys, you know, for that prayer, because it's prayer what usher us in the kingdom of God, you know. And God, when the Bible says ask and it shall be given, and if we ask anything concerning this, will, he hears us, and that's the will of God to pray, you know, for my salvation. And here I am today. The journey was something, because when you go through the experiences that I have been through as a child, you know, good, bad, and the ugly, gun violence, I mean, you name it, you know, political violence, war, crimes, and you pass through all of different kind of musical life, where you go through dancehall, from dancehall to stage show, from stage show to recording, from recording to international acclaim, signing to record companies and labels, making millions of dollars, touring all over the world, been to Japan, I've been to Africa, Europe, you name it. After that time, you tell yourself that, well, Andy, I mean, you walk with a gun, you almost get killed. Your family them get killed by gunshot, either by police or gunman. You make millions of dollars and you're still unhappy. And you feel like you don't get reach a goal by this, but at the same time, you're so depressed. You know, crowded room and feel like a lonely person. Think about it. And so I reached the end of my road. Looking back, I just said, end of it. There's no other place to go. And I remember in 1997, I went to Africa with a group named Third World, reggae group Third World from Jamaica. I went to Africa to do this tour. And when I got back from that tour, that's when God really started dealing with me, ministered to me about myself and my life. You know, you don't read Bible, but you just read Bible because of things to do. You might say, oh, Father, prayer because something that you want to do. You know, in them days, I was looking towards Rasta more than anything else back then, you know, and so forth. But this particular time when I got back, God really started prick my heart about Christ. I wasn't a person who loved church. I never grew up in church. I don't remember 4 or 5 days in Sunday schools. I don't remember nothing much about church than seeing street meetings and stuff in the ghetto. And I said to my wife, I just feel like we need to know Christ. I need to know Jesus. Nobody have to tell me anything. Before that, I was thinking about Selassie, but Selassie erased out of my mind at that point. All I could see is that I need Jesus. I can't explain it. The conviction was high, and I'm saying, wonder if I just go too far, wonder if I've said so much, and God will never forgive a man like me. But I know in my heart, I did not need Selassie. I need Jesus. You know, I need Jesus. It was not church sermon. It wasn't anything. I just know it was Christ. You know, and when you read through scripture, sometimes you're not Christian, but when God ready to convict you from his word, he will convict you. And he convicted me. I think it goes on for a couple of days. And I said to my wife, I need to talk with a pastor because my mind is all over the place. You know, a side of me saying this, a side of me saying that. But in my heart, I want to know if Jesus Christ loved me and if he will forgive me. And at that time, again, you know, remember, you know, I'm coming out of the Rastafarian cult at the time. And now, I'm not even looking in that direction at that moment. You know, I'm looking to Christ now. I'm looking to Jesus, who I never used to look for back in the past. You know what I'm saying? So this is a different moment, a different feeling that is coming on. And I said to my wife, I really, really want to know who Jesus is, you know? And she said, let us go down to a church and speak with the pastor and talk to him about what you're going through in your mind and all that. Them time, the music was the last thing on my mind. And I think anything about music at the time, nothing about music. You know, I was so caught up in knowing Jesus more than anything else. Music was like nothing. I don't remember that I was an artist. I was, you know, shaking, concerned about my soul. I'm telling you, it was like heavy, heavy conviction. Never feel anything like that before. And I went down to the church and I spoke with the pastor, my wife and I, and tell him about what I'm going through, you know, and how I felt. And I really want to know Christ, but I don't know Christ feel about me because I remember I don't grow up in church. I don't know nothing much. All I grew up from see is my father, born in weed, and all of my most of my friends are Rasta. I don't really know much, you know. And so I really want to know this Jesus, and the pastor does. He knew exactly what I was going through, and he spoke with us, my wife and I. My wife was already, her heart was already made up, but my mind was firm that I said in myself that if I know that Jesus loved me and he forgive me, I'm going to serve him. I will never look back. Never look. Because my heart was so fixed, was so made up to know Christ. And he brought us into his office. And he asked us if we want to receive Christ. And I was, oh, yes, I'm ready. Them time, again, them time, I don't remember I was an artist. I don't care what the world think. Music was the last thing on my mind. All was in my head at the time. You need Jesus. That's all it was.
Man,
Jesus, and you know, the prayers answer, and you know, we receive Christ, we surrender, we repent. I cried for months. Because when I surrender my life and receive Christ as my personal Lord and Savior, and he forgive me, wash me, and cleanse me, it's like a light bulb turn on. It's the only thing I can explain it.
Yes,
and I'm looking back at my past, and it's like, what, this is how I used to live. And I broke down because I couldn't believe I was living like that, actually.
Amen. Amen.
And when you really think about it, you say, once I was blind, but now I can see.
Amen.
That Sam, kind of experience. Yes. You know?
Papa San, I know that many people are called by the Lord long before they actually surrender. Sometimes as children, they feel a calling on them as teenagers and so on. Was there any other time before that when you just felt a nudge that God was calling you?
I know I was special in some way because I remember back then in the 80 election time when gunshot of fire hard, I stood on Panokana and Andela Vega, and I'm a friend them one time, Panaluko, unfinished horse, Pana Winda Ledge. And with the other so little kind of would have stood on and read, you know, the ghetto and thing. And a lady, I passed, I come from church and just turned to me and said, "Yeah, life to the Lord." And I said, "Why she don't speak about me? You know, she just planned me out, you know." And so from the time that God was just moving on people's heart towards me, you know, and I know that there was something special about my life as well. I just never know how to put it together. And honestly, when I was out in the Rastafarian thing and trying to get involved in the Rastafarian, I was searching it at the same time, you know. I wasn't fully embedded in the Rastafarian culture. I was searching and, you know, fathering and smoking and sitting and talking about Selassie, but I was searching in my heart.
Mm-hmm.
And recognize the search and reveal the truth to me and get me out of that and put me into his kingdom and giving me Jesus Christ the center and the master of my life. You know, it's the greatest decision I've ever made in my life is to know Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior.
Amen. Amen. Papa San, I once heard the story about you, about a white lady who called you out once. And at that time, you had an experience with a police officer putting a gun at your head. I heard that testimony. Can you talk to us about that?
There's two things here. When I just got saved early, Pastor Kathy, and I think she's in Long Island too. Great friend of mine, is like a mother to me. Great family, loved dearly. And she prophesied about the things that she see coming in my life. And in time, that was my early walk of Christianity.
Mm-hmm. There
was things coming, you know. And it's just like she was seeing people and crowds and so much things she was prophesying that day. And I never have an album out at the time. I never really start fully engaging music at the time. But I live to see how God bring those things to pass. I see where I go over the world and the things and people coming from different angles and different life, thousands of people coming, listening to the songs and receiving Christ as well as, you know, and so forth. And so she was one of the early person that prophesied in my life. The incident about, you know, with the gun situation is when, you know, I wasn't saved at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And, I was out trying to protect myself because I remember I was driving in from Portland, I think from a concert. And when I got home, my mother-in-law said to me that they're trying to kill you like your brother as well. And then kind of, I always have a gun for me, I have a gun in my front pocket. And she said, don't go to the show at Fort Clarence today because they're planning to kill you there. And I said, what is this? You know, who's trying to kill me for what? You know, so in trying to defend myself and know I have a piece in my front pocket, you know, I went over to my cousin to get a bigger gun than what I have. And during that time when I went over there, you know, I was trailed by the police. They were watching me all along. And they pulled up. And it was just horrible from there. You know, I never find a shot, but shot was firing back and forth with police and those who are with me as well. And I just couldn't do nothing more than just surrender right there in terms of what happened. And I was jailed, you know.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of stuff during that time, you know, and even during the time when police surrounded me and had me captured and they found the gun that I have, when police come from back up, because they were contemplating about if they should kill me or not. And so one set is saying kill him, the next set is saying you can't kill him, he's a big artist, you can't do stuff like that. One set is saying set example, kill. That kind of a thing. It's all a back and forth situation. And I was just there waiting for the verdict if I'm going to dead or not, because the police was already loaded with gunshots. My cousin got shot, he eventually died, and they decided that they're going to carry me to the police station. And for that, there's a police that walk up from behind me and then he just decided that mother's end it. And when he's pressed the trigger, you know, it just never go off, never fire.
Mm-hmm. So what I'm hearing, Papa San, is purpose.
Yeah. God had a purpose for your life.
God had a hold on you long before you even knew it.
Exactly.
And that's the reason why I ask you the question, because I want our listeners to understand when God has called you, he's going to keep you for that purpose.
Nobody can put you out.
Nobody can prevent you from your purpose.
So many times I could have lost my life, you know, in different ways, and God has spared me, you know, and I'm still standing here. They could have killed me that night. I want to tell the joke of this. When I got saved, I did a show in Atlanta. And a gentleman came backstage and said, "You remember me?" And I said, "No." And he said, I was the police that was begging for your life the night when they molested the gun, and I'm a Christian and I came to your concert.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah, the same police that was begging for my life became a Christian and came to my concert when I'm a Christian and tell me that with my mouth. You know, so you can imagine that, you know, that kind of a story to see how God barely out of something and then join you back with the very person. So God used him to help speak on my behalf and join back with him when we both got saved and in the kingdom of God. When God have a purpose and a calling in your life, nothing can happen.
Amen. And you know what verse that comes to mind? Many are the plans of a man's heart, but it is the Lord who directs his steps.
Amen. Praise God.
Praise God.
Awesome. Awesome.
Prophet, tell us now about your journey now, your life from there, from your salvation experience, and now as a married man and as a leader, pastor. Talk to us about this journey.
Oh, this journey is amazing. You know, it's growth and learning and understanding. Oh God, when I just got saved, there was so much residue and there was so much luggages that I came in with, you know, past experiences, failures, different things like that, making money, never have my peace. And then my wife and I, we lived together for 13 years time, you know? And so what really happened is that I have to start do some things differently. And so what I did, I tell my pastor if he could start a Bible study with us, differently from Wednesday at church and differently from Sunday at church. I need our own Bible study to get deeper in the Word of God. And we did that. And that is where the foundation really built. And we just built our life based on the Word of God, studying the Word of God, understanding the Word of God. And then God started to bring out of me the gift of teaching and teaching His Word as well. And that's what I'm doing today. But it's a journey where God wants me to continue to do music for Him, for His glory, use the gift that He has given me for His glory. And that's what I continue to do, doing that through music. And so we go through the sea of what, the same road everybody else walk. We never skip wrong and try to jump a fence because you claim that you're a celebrity. There's no celebrity in the kingdom of God. You have to stick like everybody else, have to join the line like everybody else, have to serve a church like everybody else. You know, you have to do everything where everybody else do. You know, and that's what we did. We know we put down all the stardom, we put down all the accolades and all those things. And humble ourselves before God, and we said God is in control of our lives, He's our master, and we have to submit ourselves to Him, and that's what we did. And I traveled with my pastor, share my testimony and stuff like that, and start putting music together. And everything just escalated from there. God just started opening serious doors on the gospel arena side. But I wasn't looking for things like that. I never came in looking for to be a bigger artist. I was in my prime before I got saved. And I know that couldn't help me from the past. So why am I coming in looking to be a bigger? I want to know Jesus. That's it. I let Jesus do what He wants to do in my life. But in doing so, then God opened doors for major contracts for record companies. I got 7 Billboard Top 10 album consecutively, you know, and that's just so much different accolades after giving away all the awards from the past and the secular awards. I burned everything with fire. You know, I completely cleaned my house out, and God restored me back with all different kinds of gospel awards, unheard of gospel awards, like instead of the artists. And so all those things, plus, and most importantly, the souls them that receive and that receive Christ as a born again believer. Going back to Uganda again, and the crowd is like more, almost 6, 7, 8 times. I can't even tell you more than when I went there with Third World, and people get saved left, right, and center. So it's no comparison with the past, secular, and what I'm experiencing in the gospel. God moved on every side in my life, and it's a beautiful, beautiful journey. Yes, you learn. Yes, you have struggles. Yes, you suffer late. Yes, you face persecution. But no, you're not fighting on your own. Christ is fighting for us.
Mm-hmm. Amen. So I've heard that you have just released a new album. Talk to us about that and the purpose.
Coming on the same purpose, life lessons. You know, I would not speak about my experiences, what I've learned from other people and what other people experience as well. And all of us can also talk about things that we experience in our life that everybody is familiar with. And so life lesson is all about life and life experiences and how God takes us through things, out of things, prevent us from things. That's what the album is about. It talks about that my love about you. Even the rent and the bills them due. God will never leave you like on like glue. You make everything new that my love about you. So sometimes people can say things about you. People can say things, you know, negative or try to tear down and make you feel like you can't go nowhere in life. And in the midst of all of that, God bless you right in front of your eyes. And they will see you getting blessed and don't know what to do with it. And so this is the kind of God that we serve when you walk upright and faithful before Him. You know, and that's what we love about Christ. And we go to different Psalms and life lessons. It talks about my journey in life and experiences and other people's experiences. And oh God, divert us from some of them, take us through some of them, prevent us from some of them. God working in our everyday lives. That's what Life Lesson Album is all about. And it's good for everybody to listen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. I'm going to ask you a question for us to know a little bit more about you. What is one thing that keeps you up at night? No.
Sometimes I can have a sermon. You know, God is talking to me about a sermon, and trust me, it's just a bubble in my spirit, and I'll there write it out. It could be a song as well. It could be many other things too as well, you know, that will keep me up at night. But sometimes it's either listening to a sermon or probably writing a sermon or writing a song, you know, can keep me up. And then sometimes you have other everyday affairs that can keep up at night. But, you know, that is one of the things that I can tell you. You know, when God is speaking and showing you sermon and teaching you certain things, sometimes in bed, man, I'm lying down to sleep and I just get up back and just take up again and start note down again. It's just keep flowing, you know. And sometimes it's just a lyric, sometimes it's an idea. Sometimes it's just how you plan and how you want to do things in your everyday life, you know, and so forth. So sometimes when everything shut down and it gets silent, you know, those are the moments you can hear clearly, and those are the times when you can think and look through things and evaluate yourself and do some self-examination and all of that. You know, that is one of some of the things, you know, but there's several other things there that keep me balanced.
Thank you. And if there's anything that you could change about your past, or what would it be?
My past, if I could change. Wow, if I could know Jesus earlier.
Yes.
Yeah, that changed a whole lot, you know. Mm-hmm. Jesus earlier, that changed a whole lot. You know, I would have to go through some of the things that I've been through. And, you know, but again, you know, what can you do? You know, just life, and you can't predict it. You don't know. Mm-hmm. You'll end up sometime, but you just have to just keep going with Christ, you know. So that's what it is. But, yeah, if I could just know Jesus earlier.
Yes, yes. That's great. And I just want to ask you to use this forum now to talk to the young men in communities who are just struggling, and those who just decided that they're going to give up and they're going to take a life of crime because there's no hope. There's no father figure, as you said. There's no mother. And they just feel like giving up, and they tend to gravitate towards the gang because that's where they feel home. Use this forum to talk to them.
Yeah, I just want to show you that, you know, many of us, you know, grew up with no parents, sometimes one parent, you know, and it's tough, and I understand. But three voids in every person, or three empty space, I call them. One for your mother, one for father, one for God. If you don't have the mother and you don't have the father, God can fill all three. Always remember this. If you don't have the father, but you have the mother, God can fill the space of a father. Because when he comes in, he will father you. When he comes in, he will nurture you. He will give you all that you need. Because only what Christ do through you will last. And so sometimes, you know, people looking for using material things to fill those voids. If you notice a man who don't have money, feel that money is his problem. As soon as he make money, he realize that money was not even the solution, because he's still more depressed than anything else. Guy's trying to use material things to fill that void, and it cannot be filled. So he tried drugs, he tried girls, he tried different cars, different homes, sleeping in the best hotels, eating the best and sweetest food he can find, and he's still empty. Can't fill the void. Until he come to a relationship with Jesus Christ and have that peace. You find an ex-man who's a farmer, he live into a little house, and he just have one bed, a dresser, and just a little bicycle or a donkey to ride, and he have peace every day, tranquil, no stress, no idiot, total peace. What's the difference? Christ, that man of Christ. And so no material things can fill it. So young people, let me just tell you, I know you want to pursue your dream, you want to pursue your goal. Pursue your soul, the issue about your soul first. That is more important. And everything else will fall in place. The scripture says, why gain the world and lose your soul? Get into a relationship with Jesus Christ and let him come and indwell you by the Holy Spirit coming and indwell you and give you the peace that you need and give you direction that you need so you can govern your life. And for me personally, you know, my life is a blessing. You see how God unfold and oh God, display things out to me, and also show me things that I need to know and correct me in errors and give me understanding. And now I look back on my life and I said, I'm still with the same woman, you know, today.
Praise God.
38 years together, you know, all my kids, you know, love each other, you know, and I see having gone kids now as well. So I see where God unfold everything in my life. You know, it's not by power, but by my spirit, said the Lord. And so you have to give God his place in your life. And once you give God his place, everything else will fall in place. But if you take the main person out and try to fill his place with material things and your personal wants and desire, it's a bit a temporary fix. You know, you drink some liquor tonight, you have a hangover the next morning. You make love to a girl tonight, you catch AIDS the next 2 weeks. And so it never worked. You need Jesus Christ to be the center of your life, to govern your life, to steer your life, to guide your life to that place that you need to go. So my advice to you is not to tell you how to fulfill your dream. It's to tell you how to make the one who can make it happen for you the right and proper way, and to introduce you to him. And his name is Jesus. But you have the same issue. You have the same problem. You have the soul issue that you have to deal with. And this is what Christ did when he died for us and was raised from the dead. He dealt with that so you can be able to have his grace and his mercy if you receive him.
Amen. So, Papa-san, I am a troublemaker, you know. Before I ask you a question, I'm going to ask you to give us a little of your fastest lyrical.
I don't know if it's fastest, yeah, it works.
I heard that you're the fastest lyrical DJ.
I don't know that the fastest lyrical.
Yes. And I have heard that you're the fastest. I've heard you sing, and I've used all your songs for kids to do dance and you name it. And I need to hear something.
It's not really fast. The most fastest. I have a whole lot of fast songs in and out. And I just naturally talk fast at times, you know, and that's me. You know, people just label me as that. But you know, is that really not? He just magnificent to tell them,
yes, thank you. Now, I've heard that you recently released or will be releasing your book on marriage in September.
Yep,
and yes. We would love you to come back with your wife to talk to us about some of the intricate details of marriage.
Yes, that's my heart. We've been doing Wedding Wednesdays for years. And in 2019, Dr. Dawson was there with his wife as well. We did a renewal of vow and a ship cruise, and it was beautiful. And we have some little seminars and they're teaching about marriages and stuff. So my wife and I really lock into that, because I realize that when our home is divided, it divides the parents from the children. And we just talk about the fatherlessness, and we try to avoid those things to keep marriages together. So this book is called I Do, I Don't, We Will, We Won't. That's the title of it. And it tell you what is marriage and how you can able to keep your marriage stable, and how you can able to get rid of some things in your marriage and what to prevent yourself from. Very powerful, powerful book to read. And I was talking about my personal life experiences and so forth.
I'm looking forward to reading your book, and also looking forward for the next interview with you, where you and your wife will come and talk to us on raw and unedited stories. And before you go today, do you have anything to say to our listeners, anything at all?
We're living in the end time, and I've been through so much in life, you know, so much ups and downs, hills and valleys, and then experienced success and fame, money, making millions, and living a life, a dream life, and find myself still empty, depressed, frustrated, and confused. I know that money can't solve it, and we have seen for ourselves that many movie stars and artists that have money committed suicide, and the money couldn't help them. And so I look back on life and I said, what is life? You know, life to me is Christ, is to have Christ. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. And so I just want to encourage everyone out there that if you know Christ, keep going for him, keep living. You know, for him, keep doing what he calls you to do, because he saved you by his grace. He did not earn it. He gave you as a free gift. So at least you can give him back your service back to him. For those who don't know him, really come to a place to know who Jesus is. because he's the center of everything. Everything that you need is packaged in Jesus Christ. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you notice that term, I am the way, I am the truth. He personalized it to himself. So if you need to know the truth and the way, the life, is Jesus. He's a person. And so when you go to him and ask him to forgive you of your sins and ask him to cleanse you, believe that he died and that he was raised from the dead, and you confess that with your mouth and surrender genuinely to him and say, God, I am yours today. Take me as I am. He saved you right there. You could have been in a prison cell, a hospital bed, no matter where you are, God can save you anywhere. Amen. And if you are that person, just come in a relationship with him by surrendering and asking to forgive you of your sins and receive him as your Lord and Savior and believe that he died from and was raised from the dead, and just receive him as he died for you. And doing that will get you into a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And I advise you to do that. You know, my life is a living testimony to show the goodness of Jesus Christ. You know, and no money could solve my problem. No amount of girls I have could solve my problem. You know, but when I received Christ, he settled it all. Amen. Because everything is packaged in him. Praise God.
Amen. Amen. I thank you, Tyrone Thompson, aka Papa San, for sharing your heart, for sharing Jesus with us. I am truly convicted as well, you know, with your walk. I am inspired. So I am sure our listeners are inspired as well. And to our listeners, thank you for tuning in to Raw and Unedited Stories. And if you have a story to tell, click the link below. And remember to subscribe on the button on the right corner of this page. And see you for our next episode. Have a phenomenal day.